Welcome. My name is Gabriel Broadbar. I'm the executive director of the NYU Reynolds Program in Social Entrepreneurship. And I'd like to welcome all of you to the first event of our 9th annual NYU Reynolds Social Entrepreneurship in the 21st Century Speaker Series. Tonight's event is entitled The Battle for the Soul of the Social Sector with Ken Berger, the CEO and president of Charity Navigator. I'm really, really excited that Ken is with us tonight for two related reasons. The first is that the work that Charity Navigator is doing is of such critical importance to the social entrepreneurial sector. The second is some of the things that Ken is going to be sharing with us tonight, I think, really reflect some of the foundational underpinnings of the Reynolds program. We define social entrepreneurship as pattern-breaking work of social importance that's done in ways that are sustainable and scalable. So in other words, it's not simply business skills that are applied to social and environmental ends. We see that as certainly as an important tool, but it's not the entire toolkit, right? Instead, social entrepreneurship for us is really an opportunity to break down the false distinctions between the helping professions on the one hand and the non-helping professions on the other. Sustainable, scalable social change, which is the whole point of the social entrepreneurship field, is going to require the skills and expertise of players from the public, private, and yes, the nonprofit sector. Unfortunately, I think too often the term social entrepreneurship is taken to be a repudiation of the nonprofit field, and I think this is a very dangerous and a very misguided notion. And not just because $335 billion was donated to nonprofits in the US last year alone. I think the truth is that the nonprofit sector has always played and will always play a critical role in realizing social change. There are problems for which the markets will never offer a solution, and for which nonprofits are really the only organizations that have the skills and the expertise and frankly the will to effectively address. That being said, certainly we would be hard-pressed to deny that the social sector, the nonprofit sector, is facing some serious challenges. Sometimes results aren't measured, and if they are, they're not measured accurately, or they're not disseminated, and as a result, best practices don't scale. Sometimes bad programs get funded year after year, and really great and innovative and promising solutions die on the vine due to lack of adequate resources. But as I think we're going to learn tonight, the solution is not the wholesale rejection of the nonprofit community, which some people have actually suggested. Instead, it may lie in dramatically increasing the efficiency in the flow of information, expertise, and feedback among the many players that make up this vast nonprofit ecosystem. I hope you've brought a really open mind and a genuine desire to participate in the conversation. Following the presentation, we'll have about 30 minutes for a very candid conversation with Ken. For those of you that are joining us in cyberspace, please tweet your questions to at NYU Reynolds or hashtag NYU SoCen. And with that in mind, please join me in warmly welcoming Mr. Ken Berger.
Thank you, David. Thanks so much. Hi, everybody. Thank you all for coming. I'm really honored to be here. I have a personal connection to NYU because my father went to school here, my wife went to school here, and Charity Navigator has a real connection to NYU because 3 years ago we co-hosted a mini conference at the Wagner School called Managing to Outcomes with Professor Dennis Smith. So it's really a privilege to continue that connection, and there have been a lot of other ways, but this is a very rare opportunity for me because this is one of those few times that we have an opportunity to speak to a wide open audience. It's not just the students here at NYU, it's not just professors or necessarily some of the nonprofits that we work with and rate, but it's also the general public and supporters of Charity Navigator. So with such a wide audience, I may, for some of you, say things that are rudimentary and obvious, and for others, things that may sound a little strange. So I'm going to try to find a balance amidst all of this, and I hope it makes sense. So just a little bit about me first. I spent 30 years running nonprofits. I was in the trenches every day. And then after 30 years, I got this job at Charity Navigator for a variety of reasons, but partly it was I was unemployed. And another part of it was that the founder of Charity Navigator said, why would you want to go from direct service to essentially sitting in front of a computer every day? And I said, because I can affect the lives and help the lives of perhaps 1,000 people a year when I run charities. At Charity Navigator, I could influence billions of dollars that are being given by millions of people and hopefully drive that money to the highest performing nonprofits. And according to legend, that's how I got the job. So that's just to give you context. So one of the things that's another weird thing, in addition to the audience being so wide, is my experience of going from being in the direct service in New York City on the street serving homeless people and other underserved populations to now being at this 50,000 foot level looking at the sector as a whole. And so that's the perspective I'm going to try to bring to you today and convey to you from what I've learned from those 30 years and all the gray hairs that you see. So I'm calling this a battle. And you know, as we are talking about this, the world has all kinds of conflicts going on. There's war weariness, and all the evidence is this is going to continue. So in one sense, I apologize for my dramatic language. But at the same time, I do feel it's warranted. And when I talk to my colleagues who are still in the sector and compare notes with them on how it is in the trenches, when we speak privately, we often tend to agree on the things that I'm going to share with you today. But there are very few of us that are able to talk about it. Part of the reason that most of my colleagues are not able to talk about it publicly is because of the nature of the social sector, and more particularly my experience in the nonprofit sector, where speaking out when it comes to issues, when it comes to advocacy, when it comes to the environment and healthcare and education, certainly there are organizations that do that. But when it comes to speaking about looking at ourselves and how we operate the sector, there aren't that many of us that are able to do it and do it bluntly. I get paid to do it bluntly. It's a very cool job in that sense. But for my colleagues, where you don't want to offend anyone, and most of them in nonprofits, where you want to make sure you maximize your funding, and you don't want to offend a funder that might be conservative, liberal, or whatever value system that might be, you're trying to go to the middle and maximize your funding typically, and it minimizes your ability to necessarily be blunt and talk about some of the bad things that are happening. And so I'm going to do that. I call this, you know, when Gabriel spoke to me earlier, he said, you know, we're looking for visionary, inspiring leaders talking about the sector. And I was thinking, I didn't say it to Gabriel, but the first half of my speech is what I call the bummer. And it's not inspiring. So I'm going to drag you through the battlefield first and tell you what I see the problems are. And then in the second half, I hope to uplift you. So I hope you can make it through to the end, but I'm warning you in advance, I'm about to be a bummer. And so with that, the battle. I need to do one quick thing first and tell you just a little bit about Charity Navigator. We've been around since 2001. We launched our website in 2002, and we were created by the Dugan family, who the founder described themselves at the time, at one time in their life, they were almost billionaires. And they aren't at that much today, but they founded Charity Navigator because they were self-made and they wanted to find a place where they could get information on, objective information on nonprofits. They saw what was going on with Hale House, Covenant House, United Way, and they were looking for an independent source of information. They found what was available wanting, and so they decided to create Charity Navigator. And they did it also because they figured most wealthy individuals may create a foundation or something of that nature, give anonymously or privately, but they figured maybe we can create something that's not just for us, that's for everybody, and that's completely free. We would never charge anybody anything for it. We would never take money from any charity, so that we would always be independent and objective and be able to speak out on the issues and be a voice for donors that are often not heard from in a clear way. So, the mission, to be a guide to intelligent giving. And so our core audience are the people who are givers and, in today's parlance, hopefully social investors, and especially those that are giving to nonprofits. But increasingly, it's going beyond that, as the audience knows better than most. And our tagline is essentially that all the research shows that the vast majority of people who give to nonprofit organizations do so from the heart, and we certainly don't want to get rid of the heart. The heart should always be a part of the passion and the drive that makes you want to help. But we want to have the head involved, because we often find that data is not being utilized, and you need to use your head so you don't become heartbroken in the process of giving. And then the other thing which I've come to appreciate, and I've suggested that we add as another way that we look at ourselves at Charity Navigator, is we see ourselves as a critical friend to the social sector. We are critical, and we're one of the voices that will speak bluntly, hopefully, about the good and the bad and the ugly. But we're also a friend, and we hope to drive more money to high-performing social service organizations and to inspire and to educate and to encourage more social sector organizations to become more results-driven and better and higher performing. And that also helps donors, because the more of them there are, the more places there are for donors and social investors and shareholders for social businesses to concentrate their money. So as of last year, we had 7 million visits. We are now reviewing enough nonprofits that are covering about where 55% of all charitable gifts go each year, which is $110 billion once you take out the houses of worship. We rate the charities on a scale of 0 to 4 stars based on their performance on a variety of metrics. And Charity Navigator is a charity too, so afterward, please donate generously to Charity Navigator. Now, on to the battle. So, you'll notice this is my second fantasy science fiction slide. Please bear with me. I am a lover of science fiction. The first was Lord of the Rings. This is The Matrix, in case you didn't know. So, sometimes I have friends and family that say to me, I'm not into politics. And I'll say, well, that's a political decision. Being apolitical is a political choice. And therefore, you have given more power and influence to those that are involved. And the same applies in this battle that I'm going to tell you about. Not knowing about it, you can still be a pawn. And I would say, I speak for myself, I'm not judging anybody. I was a pawn for almost 30 years before I figured this out with help from my friends, so please don't take it as an offense if I suggest that you might be a pawn in this battle. So first, I just want to show you what I often hear some of the thought leaders out there say about what are some of the biggest challenges in the social sector. Well, first, when it comes to nonprofits, we have 1.6 million or more and climbing, depending on who you ask. We have the largest nonprofit sector in the history of the world. Gabriel mentioned $335 billion are going to charitable contributions, and that is true. But here's something I didn't know before I came to Charity Navigator. There's going to be a few of these aha moments. I didn't know this with 30 years in the trenches. It's not 330 some odd billion that is involved overall. That's not to say Gabriel didn't know this. But it's $2 trillion a year. Charitable contributions are the smallest bucket of money. That 300 billion is the smallest bucket. And so there's $2 trillion, one out of every 10 jobs in this country. And I'll get back to where that other money comes from later. And so in a place like New York, some people say there's more charities per square inch than anywhere else in the world. And the competition is fierce, and it's becoming more and more difficult as a crowded space, and there's not enough control over the new entrants into the system. And so there's just too many nonprofits. Another argument that's made is, remember I said $300 billion comes from charitable contributions, twice that much or more. It's estimated to be somewhere between $600 and $700 billion comes from government. And the government's imploding in many ways in terms of some of its funding of traditional services. Most direct service charities are very reliant upon it. And so that's bad. By the way, I can't see anything on the screen here. And then last but not least, we have overhead and CEO salaries. We have people like Dan Pallotta who will say, we're starving for the costs to build the administrative, the fundraising, and all the other parts of the nonprofit sector. So on that side of the coin, there's just not enough there. We're not getting the right leadership. We're not paying enough. These are the things that a lot of people are saying. And I'm not going to debate those things. There are some of those things I think are true, others less true. But I think there's an even bigger problem, a fundamental problem, when it comes to the battle for the soul of the social sector. And it starts with a quote from a colleague of mine who told me that when he wrote this, he got more heat, he got in more trouble than he did in his entire career, and he still gets yelled at for it. And his basic point is not saying that nonprofits don't provide social value. What he is saying is that most nonprofits can't prove it. They can't provide objective data and evidence. And when we look at social businesses that are largely in the early stages, I suspect it's not that much of a stretch in many cases that we still have a problem regardless. Charity Navigator has been gathering information on this for a number of years now. And what we have found confirms David Hunter's quote here. And there's an article you can get online for free called The End of Charity if you want to read more about this bummer. And so at Charity Navigator, what we have found is that the vast majority of nonprofits do not publicly report in any meaningful way on their results. We've been gathering this now for a couple of years, and the vast majority have very, very little information when it comes to meaningful results, outcomes, some people call it impact, very, very little. We also think anecdotally, if you go under the surface, there's a second reality, which is that they couldn't provide that information no matter how hard they tried because they don't have the systems in place. They don't have performance management and measurement in place. So even if they want to, they just can't do it. And I'm not blaming the charities. This is not a beat up on the charities point. There are real, very understandable reasons for this in many cases, and there's plenty of blame to go around. But it's a very sobering reality when the largest nonprofit sector in the history of the world has virtually a minute amount of evidence in some very discrete subsectors, but for the overall majority, there's virtually nothing. That's the battle. That's the core battle, as I see it. So in a situation like this, where there's no evidence, what becomes the default? Who wins the battle if there's no objective evidence in most cases? I believe that the rule is whoever does the best marketing wins. And marketing is important. Be you a social business or a nonprofit, you need to market what you're doing. You need to fundraise in the case of the nonprofit. You need to raise funds for capital as a social business. You have to market yourself. But if that's the default, and if there's no objective evidence for that marketing, then what is your typical default? It's storytelling. Storytelling is very important. You have to get granular to touch people's hearts. You want to tell those stories. There's nothing wrong with stories. Data without stories is dead. You need stories. But if there's no data behind most of those stories, then you have a very broken system, I would argue. So here's another example of something I never knew before I came to Charity Navigator. 30 years in the trenches, I did not know what I'm about to share with you. So no matter what your politics are, whether you're on the left, right, center, you've certainly heard of the Occupy Wall Street movement. And the Occupy Wall Street movement is upset because 43% of the nation's wealth is in the hands of 1% of the US population. Imagine regardless of your politics, imagine if it was double that. What if 86% of the nation's wealth was in the hands of 1%? I think more people would be really mad. I think that our society would be in a lot of trouble. Well, guess what? Here's what I learned. That's what the nonprofit sector is, what it's like. 1% of the nonprofits in this country garner 86% of the revenues that come into the sector each year. Tap the screen. I tapped the screen. So anyway, as I was saying before, that little digression. So think about that. Twice as much is going into the hands of 1%. Now, so out of 1.6 million nonprofits, you're talking 16,000, maybe 20,000. Yes, they're largely universities and hospitals. But if you look at the sector as a whole, there is a tendency of this concentration in most cause areas. If you look around the world, you see the same phenomena, predominantly this kind of concentration. So what does that mean for creativity? What does that mean for innovation? What does that mean for the ability of some of the smaller organizations to get to scale? Who has the vested interest in keeping the system the way it is? Now, mind you, I'm not saying that the large organizations are all bad. I'm not saying that there aren't innovators and creative and dynamic things. I'm not a complete enemy of bigness. But there is at least some part of that community that is not interested in seeing change. And if you look at the statistics on the number of organizations that scale up each year, it is abysmal. They can actually get bigger, some of these creative, innovative organizations. I think social business is one attempt to try to break through that dilemma. But I have some bummer things to say about social business in a few minutes. But at any rate, so given this situation that we have the Occupy Charity problem, as I call it, we also have another problem, what I would call the Occupy Foundation problem. Out of the 82,000 foundations that give out money each year, there are 50 that give out more than half the money and have more than half of the resources. And so there is a tendency, and again, I'm not saying that there's anything wrong necessarily with being a big foundation with lots of money to give out. By all means, if you hear me out there, I have no problem with that in theory. But in practice, what often happens is the big brand names, the big nonprofits, and the big foundations tend to work together. And there's a tendency for this gridlock and this lack of scaling up the smaller organizations to be sort of baked into that system. So it can be surmounted, but it is a big obstacle. And then the 800-pound gorilla that I mentioned earlier. Foundations are about $45 billion a year of the $330 billion that is private contributions, right? You got individual is about $250 to $270 billion. You got foundations, $40 to $50 billion, and then $5 or $6 billion from corporations. That's the smallest bucket. That's the private contribution bucket, about 15% of the money. And includes the foundations, $40 billion. Think $40 billion for foundations. So think of the problems the foundations have. And then the 800-pound gorilla has those problems and more. And the 800-pound gorilla is the government. The government. And this is federal, state, and local government. As I said, $600 to $700 billion. So all those problems I mentioned of scale and bigness are there. But in this case, we have lots of evidence of political favoritism over the quality of the results and meeting true mission purpose, a tendency to dumb down the programs so that you have an innovator and we want to try to reduce the cost, and so we noodle with your program. We also, at government, oftentimes don't pay the full cost, the infrastructure costs, so you have to go and raise money for these programs that we're telling you to run in a way that you didn't run them before. And by the way, we're very bureaucratic and slow, and we probably won't pay you on time. And so you're going to have to figure out a way to cover your costs because we're chronically late in paying you. So basically, government, from what I see, is the all-around worst funder there could be. It's really bad. But it's where the lion's share of the money is. And then we come to the donor, the donors that Charity Navigator is trying to help. There was a study that was done by a group called Hope Consulting. And it's supposed to be the most thorough study of its kind in about 20 years. It's called Money for Good. They analyzed what they called middle to high income families, 80,000 a year or more as a family. And they tried to get a profile of what was the basis upon which people gave to charity. And I don't have time to go through all of this, but in a nutshell, what they found was that 85% of the decisions were largely revolving around emotion. And about 15% said they wanted impact. They wanted evidence of results. And then they went further and they based their next round on behavior. Okay, you said you wanted to do it this way, but how do you actually do it? And they found that it wasn't 15% that based things on impact, it was 1 or 2%. Bummer, bummer. Okay, moving on. Remember, we'll get past this. Some of you who are involved in social entrepreneurship and social business hopefully are familiar with this dilemma, the beneficiary dilemma. In a for-profit sector, if a customer doesn't like the product, they can walk with their feet and get it somewhere else. Very clear metric, go somewhere else. In the nonprofit sector, the payor, the donor, the funder is one person, and the receiver of the service, the beneficiary, is somebody else. And so the feedback signals are not coming, hardly at all oftentimes, from the person being served. And I would argue that social business does not necessarily solve this problem either. If you're concerned about your shareholders and some of the notion of a certain profit, that doesn't mean you're going to get past this one. Big problem. And then the last part of this, the social sector organizations themselves are often against and arguing against focusing on results for a variety of other reasons. One, hey, what are you telling me? You want me to get naked and be completely transparent about my results? And all these other charities, all these other social businesses are not as forthcoming? Give me a break. That's not realistic. That's a death knell. Furthermore, you want me to generate even more reports? You want me to, you know how much my funders, my all of the stakeholders are asking me to report, and now you want me to do these other reports on this results business? It's all about the work. It shouldn't be about reports and data. And not only that, your data is reductionistic. In other words, you can't possibly capture the complexity, the uniqueness, and the variety of things that we're trying to do, and we could measure the wrong things, as Einstein would point out to you. Be careful with this measurement business. You could take us down the wrong path, looking for easy things rather than what matters most. And by the way, nobody wants to pay for it. So it's all very well and good for you to say that, but if all of my funders aren't interested in paying for it, they're barely covering my costs, they don't cover my infrastructure, give me a break. My boards don't necessarily, or my shareholders don't necessarily care all that much about it. My donors, my social investors, as we've already said, aren't necessarily that interested in it. And when it comes to the nonprofits, because they don't have the profit motive, we're supposed to have the mission motive. But it's often been observed, and I've thought about this over the 30 years that I ran charities, how do you get rewarded as a CEO? You get bigger. You get more contracts. That's how you typically see your salary go up. That's an implicit proxy, oftentimes, that replaces mission. That's bad, if that's going to be the metric that we use to decide how we move forward. And then finally, on this one, we have, looking at government, which is imploding, their oversight of what I call the scoundrels and thieves, which I will talk about, is declining. And as the nonprofit sector and social business are going like this, record-breaking size, bigger and bigger and bigger, even during the Great Recession, the oversight bodies are going in the opposite direction. They're going that away. That's bad, too. The oversight is declining. It's not increasing. And Charity Navigator would be more than happy to participate in trying to deal with that, but we are a small organization, and there's a very important role that government needs to play in monitoring the problems that are out there. So maybe social business could solve that problem. Well, I do not claim to be an expert on social business, so I am somewhat dangerous, and so maybe some of you can educate me on the folly of some of this, perhaps. But I have spoken to colleagues that are doing work in social business. Those are businesses, by the way, that are trying to, in a for-profit setting in some cases, to operate and do social good, as well as nonprofits that have an entrepreneurial and creative and dynamic model to try to change things in a new way, in a creative, innovative way. The definitions are kind of vague here. But I find for some of the social businesses, there's an assumption. The whole premise, part of the premise for when the nonprofit sector was created long ago, was market failure. That there are situations where there is market failure and that we need some other avenue rather than a for-profit to solve that problem. And of course, the faith community was also very involved in this from the beginning. But there are some, and I think Gabriel mentioned it earlier, there are some that think this is the new answer to everything. And I have worked with many homeless people who will be chronically and severely and persistently mentally ill for the rest of their lives and will always need help. And there are a variety of communities and situations where you could theoretically create something in a for-profit realm, but I'd be hard-pressed to be convinced that it would be the most effective way to go about doing things. And when you're balancing profit and creating social value in that mission, I think you add even more complexity and challenges, potentially, as the line between your focus on profit and your focus on social value have to be balanced. It can become even more challenging and complex in some situations. Not necessarily the panacea that some might think that it is. I read up on social entrepreneurship a couple years ago, and I came to the conclusion that I was a social entrepreneur too. I also thought of a line from three sages from when I was young that said the words, "There's something happening here, and what it is ain't exactly clear." And so I think that social entrepreneurship and social business has a long way to go in getting a clearer picture of where things stand and what things are. I'm proud to be a social entrepreneur, but I'm not always necessarily that sure what I'm saying when I say that. So we have some work to do there too. So, and then how many proven social business examples are there? Even examples that have been pointed out, like in microfinance, we now have discovered as years have passed that there's also corruption and abuses and people that are gouging money from people in these microfinance companies, and some of them. So there's plenty of opportunity for abuse and challenges. One of the things that I also think, the Peter and Paul problem, is that we often don't talk about the reality that if social business and impact investors really get going gangbusters, is it really an endless pie, and is all the money going to come from new sources? Are we certain that we're not also going to gouge out and impact the vitally needed funds for nonprofits? Is it really a completely separate pot of money? I don't think so. And I think we have to be honest about rubbing elbows for good or ill. We want to collaborate, we want to work together, but there's also a conflict and a clash there that we have to admit. And finally, I'll just say one last thing. A colleague of mine who has been working with some groups that are going into pay for performance and is working with some of these large for-profit investment firms, he said to me, "It's a shark pool. They want 70, 80% profit. They don't give a damn about social value or social mission. They're just seeing a new way to bring in revenue. There's nothing good about it in some cases." And so we have to speak more bluntly and openly and honestly about the challenges on that side of the ledger as well. I don't think it's a panacea. I think it's important, but let's not go overboard. So that is the end of the bummer. Thank you so much. That was the non-inspiring part of my speech. So now, how do we get out of this? How do we fix this? How do we win this battle? Well, first of all, I hope it's clear when I say a battle, in most cases, I am not blaming most of the players. I don't think that they're necessarily consciously intending to be enemies of doing good by any means. So one of the biggest hopes of all is that I think that most people, I'll talk about exceptions, are well-intentioned and that are wanting to do this right. So that is probably the most important thing of all. There is hope to try to do this right. And I think a lot of the innovations in social business, a lot of the innovations with new nonprofit models have a lot to do with that, that hope to try to get past some of the many obstacles I described, and many others if we had time, if we had a few days. So here's how I would say we are going to win the battle. And by the way, I'm sorry I didn't flip through this, but I went through it verbally, so you don't need to read this. So here's how we win the battle. So this was a this was from a report that the Hewlett Foundation put out in 2008. And back in 2008, the key back then, when they called it the nonprofit sector, at least they did at that time, was the key was meaningful information. Nonprofits were going to supply meaningful information. Intermediaries like Charity Navigator were going to assess that information and share it, and donors are going to use it, social investors are going to use it, and what's going to happen? What's the winning strategy? We're going to drive more money to high-performing nonprofits. That's the winning game. And then we're going to help the world more than ever before because we're going to have a much more efficient sector where everything is meaningfully shared and decisions are made wisely. So I read this report 6.5 years ago, and I've been staring at this thing for years, and I figured out after a while they were missing a few things on this chart. And so I will now try to add. The first, of course, is what we're talking about today also, which is social business. And so I will not belabor that for the moment, but rather a couple of others that I'll put in red. One is Hewlett Foundation forgot to talk about the Hewlett Foundation and the government. And what is their role supposed to be in all of this? And so I would say to you that there's a group of us that are going to do a little play in about a month called The Wizard, the Beggar, and the Alleged Beneficiary. I won't get into the details, but the basic point is the foundation's, like here it is up to the recent past, and the foundation says, show me an output, show me an activity. And the nonprofit shows the activity. And they get the grant, they show the activity. And now, present day, after much thought and contemplation, the foundations, the government says, show me an outcome, show me an impact. And they give exact same amount of money. They don't allow additional infrastructure and overhead. They don't train. They don't guide. Do the same, do better than ever, more deep, more meaningful than ever, and we're going to give you the same amount of money. That's got to change. That's how we win. Make them change. Okay. And then there's somebody else that's been neglected, which we mentioned earlier, which are the beneficiaries, the people being served. They could be a powerful metric, a powerful voice, a powerful player, the most important in this whole system. Are we really helping them? How are we asking them whether we're helping them? It could be an incredibly powerful tool in almost any kind of social sector organization. It could be an incredibly powerful tool. And we're seeing work in this area that's very encouraging. And so once that happens, and we agree on some standards so that nonprofits have one set of things to report on rather than a million, and they're actually reporting on what matters, maybe they won't be as upset about too many reports in this winning battle strategy. And the beneficiaries will really be engaged and learn about and know about and be certain that they're getting meaningful services. So there it is. But that's not the end of what I was going to say. I want you to think of, if there's nothing else that you remember from tonight, I want you to remember my little red tricycle. Please remember my little red tricycle, okay? I thought a lot about this. It took me a long time to put this together. So a lot of the thought leaders out there now, a lot of the social sector leaders out there now say, forget about all that stuff that you've been measuring. And Berger, it sounds like you're one of these too. It's all about impact. All we should be measuring is impact. That's the most important thing. That's what you said. Let's just measure that and forget about everything else. Well, my little red tricycle feels differently. My red tricycle says you have three wheels to have momentum. Three wheels to have permanent ongoing movement. One of the wheels, it is a little wheel, is the finances of the organization. And I would say to you that any nonprofit, any social business that doesn't keep their eye on the financial ball, today's results can be tomorrow's bankruptcy. And so you should never stop looking at, measuring, and thinking about your financial health and your management of your finances. Number two, governance. I cannot tell you how many times we have found scoundrels and thieves in the rat pile because they have a board or a small group, buddies of the CEO or the leader of the organization, and it's pretty much wild in the streets. They do whatever they want. And so today's gangbuster results can be tomorrow's embezzlement, tomorrow's governmental investigation, because there was no strong oversight by a board, and that there was someone in charge that could do pretty much whatever they wanted. And then the big wheel. We call it results at Charity Navigator. It's been called impact. It's been called outcomes. It's been called a variety of other things. We agree. It is the most important thing of all. Absolutely correct. It's the big wheel. But if you want to get that tricycle moving, please don't forget the small wheels in the back. So, this is another way of looking at this that we have a bunch of us got together, a group called the Alliance for Effective Social Investing, and it took those three pieces of the tricycle and laid it out in a different way. The top, again, talks about governance. The bottom arrow talks about finance, and the middle is about results. And basically what we see in most organizations, if you want to get to high performance, if you want to get to impact, the first thing that you have is capable leadership. If you don't have capable leadership, you're not going to get there. Yes, it's great to have participatory structures. It's great to have flattened management structures. It's all very nice. But if you don't have leadership buy-in, today's results will not, you won't get the results. Because if the leaders are not going to, if you can't convince the leaders of that, you're just not even going to get to it. And so my advice to those of you who are younger than me, and to those of you who are my age, and those of you who are older than me, is if you're in an organization like that, learn, but eventually you should quit and find another organization that's really focused on results rather than someone that just doesn't get how you've got to drive data. You've got to be performance driven. Once you have that leadership, you can build the structures. High performance is where you can get to by building performance management systems. And then if you're really gangbusters and if you want to really go at it, you can get to impact. We think that most social organizations will never get to impact in the way that we define it, and we think that that's okay, because the definition that we had of impact was that you could rule out all other causation. And most nonprofits, most social sector organizations are not going to be able to do that, because it would require randomized control trials, and you're spending millions of dollars, and most organizations are not going to be able to do that. Rather, you should be an innovator and a measurer, and learn yourself. If there are no models out there, if there's no evidence out there, test and learn and see what works within your own organization. There might be some other reasons that people are getting better, but that doesn't mean you shouldn't measure and do what you can to improve your operations. A build, test, and learn kind of a model. That's what we are hoping to see more of in the social sector. There are two boxes that are missing here. You see capable leadership? To the left of that box, there's another box. It's called the clueless social sector organization. And where we stand today, for better or worse, unfortunately, that's where the majority are. But the good news is that I think we're seeing more and more of a movement towards wanting to get on to this. And then there's the box all the way to the left, and that's called the scoundrels and thieves box. Remember I said earlier, there really are some enemies in this battle. There is a clear and present danger. There is real evil out there. There are people who do not give at any, they don't care at all about helping others, about improving society. Their focus is to line their pockets. We at Charity Navigator have become experts on those people. They are real. They exist. Some of my fellow thought leaders say it is rare. It's not a big deal. It's not a big problem. And I would submit to you, I say, poppycock. or hooey. That is not correct. It is a problem. It is a big problem. And we have got to speak out about it more. They are really bad, and they can damage all of us and the trust of everyone. And so the voices of those of us who speak out bluntly about the problems, let me tell you something. It's not easy to do, because there's a tendency to want to shut you up, to sue you, to come after you. Believe me, this is a battle, and those people are real bad. So I just want to try to open your eyes. We got a problem on that end. But the good news is there are more and more organizations going this way, and the majority of organizations want to get here. So that, again, we see the direction that we have to go in. Finally, for social businesses, well, it's not finally, but when it comes to this, when it comes to social businesses, I would just, a few points, you know, again, with my knowledge of social business being not as much as nonprofits. Why, you know, I think there needs to be mutual respect. A colleague and I wrote an article called The Nonprofitization of Business. And we wrote that just really to be provocative, to say, basically, for-profit companies have all kinds of great qualities to them, and they do great things, but please don't presume that we're a bunch of knuckleheads over here that don't know how to manage things, and please don't presume that you're going to come in and just transform things because we're a bunch of dummy, you know, bleeding hearts. That's not fair. That's not right, and it's not true. Some of us are that way, but to approach the whole thing that way, it's really, the point of the article was we need to have mutual respect, and I think Gabriel touched on this also. We really need to try to learn from each other, and we need to listen to each other. There needs to be this humility. One of the people who's claimed to be the wisest man that ever lived said, "Do you see a person wise in their own eyes? There's more hope for a fool than for them." We need to have some humility. We need to have that kind of attitude. We're in the early learning stages in a lot of this, nonprofit and social business. Let's have the humility to say we don't know everything and we're going to learn together. Let's set some standards for these social businesses. Let's get some rating agencies for these social businesses. It's pretty much the Wild West out there from what I see, just as much as many of these nonprofits. We need to work together. There is an important place, I think, for social business. I think that there's a patchwork quilt that all of these kind of approaches need to be part of. And let's try to instill some of the values that we have at Charity Navigator are, let's all try to continuously improve and question things. Let's all try to work together as a team and respect every perspective, and let's try to focus on what matters most, the people that we're trying to serve. Here's another hopeful sign. Remember I said that 1% of donors are looking at information of effectiveness? Well, I say to you, when Hope Consulting asked donors, what's the most important thing to you? By far the largest response, 90% said effectiveness. Now you might say, well, wait a minute. Well, they're saying that, but they're not doing that. But wait a minute. Didn't we say earlier that the vast majority of nonprofits don't report on this stuff and social businesses too? So of course they're not going to go looking for it because it doesn't exist. Unless you have your own foundation and your program officers and do a deep dive archaeological dig, for most people, you can't find it. But clearly, people want it. And by the way, we at Charity Navigator, as we've been getting into this area, are finding increasingly that people are coming to our site more and more. And so now I want to take a break for a moment and have another speaker talk to you for about 90 seconds, because I think you might be tired of hearing me speak. So I'm going to just play a little, I'm going to try to play something here. No? Did I skip it? There. Okay. Here it comes, maybe. 90 seconds to break it up. Apparently not. It's okay. We don't need it. So what does all this have to do with Charity Navigator? I'm glad you asked that question, and here is the answer of what this has to do with Charity Navigator. Charity Navigator has been evolving our rating system for years now to get the tricycle. We had the financial health. We added governance issues. We called it accountability and transparency in 2011. And in 2013, we began to gather something we call results reporting. That's OK. It's all right. I don't have time for it anyway. So we added this thing we call results reporting. Now, why are we calling it results reporting? In 2008, when I joined Charity Navigator, we said we were going to change our rating system and rate results because the nonprofits out there were saying, you're not measuring what matters most. You're not measuring the big wheel. And so I said, OK, we'll measure results. You're right. We'll measure results. And so then we got funding. We did research. We did research. We did research. And then one day I had what I called the Sparky, Hey Sparky experience, where I looked in the mirror and I said, wait a minute, Sparky. There's a problem here. Remember, you said the vast majority of nonprofits don't report publicly? Yep. So how in the heck are you going to be able to measure them on their results if there's no information? Oh, yeah, that's true. Not going to work. So we did a rethink, and we said, what we need to do first is to measure how each charity uniquely reports on its results publicly. We're not going to compare one charity to another on these results. We're not going to expect there to be some magic list of results that you have to report on. We want each organization to be able to tell us what they are doing, and in a meaningful way that what we call here in New York, you can appreciate this, we call it the a regular person. If a regular person, if it makes sense to a regular person, then that's good. And then that's OK. And then we're going to give you some credit for that. A reasonable person says, yeah, that's good. That's where we are. We need to at least begin with that. So if you can explain, well, we're measuring this, and we're not like that other organization over there. So you know, we are unique. We want to be considered for the unique services we provide. We're saying, great. There is no agreed upon model. We're agnostic at Charity Navigator. You tell us. We're not going to impose it on you. And what we're trying to do is to drive more information into the public square so that all of us, it's not about Charity Navigator, so it becomes the norm in the social sector to share this kind of information, meaningful information. Maybe someday in the distant future there'll be a CN 4.0 where we can actually compare the results of one organization to the other. Perhaps it could be tremendously complex, and so maybe we won't. Perhaps someday we'll rate social businesses, perhaps. But for now, with those pesky 1 million nonprofits that we're working on, we want to at least start getting information out there and promoting those organizations that are beginning to talk about this. So that's what it is not. It is not. So this is not about us comparing one charity to another. It is about us asking for the charities to tell themselves their story. So there are five metrics in our new rating component on results reporting. The first is we want to know, what do you provide? And what do you say about that in your reporting to government? And what do you say about that in your on your website? Do those two things align? If not, why don't they align? And in addition, how much money goes to each different kind of program? We need to know that because this whole system is based upon program level. It's not organizational level. So that's the first thing we want to know. Second thing we want to know is what I said to you already. It's what some people call a logic model, a theory of change, a roadmap, whatever you want to call it. It's saying, here's the problem, here's the solution, here are the steps we're going to take to measure along the way at a certain dosage level to try to affect change. And the key here, by the way, is it's not so much that you're a gangbusters organization that's hitting the ball out of the park every time with amazing results. That's not what it is. What it is that we're looking for an organization that is learning and adaptive over time. So you might have terrible results at first. The key that we want to see is that in year two, you adapt and learn from those mistakes and those not hitting the markers that you were going for, and you're learning and building and growing so that you can get closer to meaningful results. We find that less than 25% of the charities are in this category from those we've looked at. In fact, it might even be closer to 10% when we look at the total. So we've got a long way to go. But we at Charity Navigator want to promote and highlight those organizations that are doing this right. There are a few other metrics we're also looking at, but I'm not going to belabor these other metrics because we're finding that most organizations are not there yet. But just to touch on it quickly, one is, do you have validators, third-party organizations that certify your results? We're also looking for beneficiary feedback. And if you have those models, that's great. And also, do you have independent as well as internal evaluations of your results from consultants, from your own work? And so once you have all of these elements, Then, when you add it all together, then what happens is you have our new special seal. No, I'm just kidding. No, that's not what that, that's just it. But at any rate, so another way to look at it is there's a group out in London that's called Nesta, and they talk about these different levels of evidence. And so what we're saying in another way is, if you can just tell that story, if you can, I know you can't read this, but level one is you can describe what you do and why it matters logically, coherently, and convincingly, level one. And level two is you capture data that shows positive change, but you can't necessarily confirm causation. You haven't done randomized control trials. If we can get more organizations that far up the chain, I can retire in peace someday. So a couple other things just want to do very quickly. How many of you have heard of the overhead myth letter? Any of you? Okay, well, the overhead myth letter was something that was written by GuideStar, the Better Business Bureau, and Charity Navigator. We signed on a couple years ago, and it was a letter to the donors of America. And basically what it said was, talked about the tricycle, although we didn't call it that, and basically said to donors, you know, there are things in addition to overhead that are important, and in fact, that should not be a primary metric by any means. It should be results. And we need to increasingly encourage you to go towards that information. So we wrote that letter. And then after we wrote that letter, I said to my colleagues, if we don't write a second letter, we could do more harm than good. That letter is bad all by itself. Because what that letter does is it says to donors, sit on your hands. Because we're telling them to go look for results, and there's nowhere to find it. So that letter might be cool to give to your institutional funders, but when it comes to the average person on the street, what do you tell them to do? Don't hold us accountable. Real bad. And so, within about a month, we're about to put out a second letter. I like to call it the overhead solution letter, or the output myth letter. And it's basically to the nonprofits and the social sector as a whole, I would hope, basically saying, you've got to get serious and do whatever it takes to get to reporting on meaningful results. You have to do it. You have to find a way. We have to get past the excuses. We have to get past the obstacles. It's got to be done. If you want donors to hold you accountable for what you consider most meaningful, then you've got to provide them with that information. And then, of course, I think there could also be a letter to social businesses called the profit myth letter, but I've already belabored that, so I won't go into it again. So now I'll give you my grand finale, and once again confirming that I am a science fiction fanatic. What I just went through with you is not meant to be the ramblings of a geek for data. This is really, really personal for me. I spent 30 years serving the underserved. I saw people get murdered. I saw people freeze to death. And I know that if we had been more focused on measuring and managing our work, we could have done a much, much better job. So what I'm talking to you today about is life and death. That's how important it is. It's not just a theoretical thought leadery argument. It's life and death stuff. That's what we need for you to consider. And what I need to urge you to consider, if you have gotten anything along these lines, if you are thinking along these lines, or if you're intrigued by this, is we need more people to become leaders in this battle. We need people to educate, to advocate to others, be it your friends, your family, your colleagues, your funders, your boards, your staff, your stakeholders, the media, everybody. There is a need for more education and more people to become aware of this battle and more people to get involved in this fight. We need you. We really need you. It can't just be a bunch of us standing up here and talking about it like this. We need more of you to get up here and to fight this battle. And I say it again. I argue again, and I hope I've convinced you. It's a battle for the soul of the social sector. The end.
Thank you so much for being here. Once again, this is a wonderful talk, and it was great on behalf of the NYU community. We're very excited to have you. So I work with an organization on campus called NYU Bridge, and we're students who are interested in social innovation and social entrepreneurship. So I'm kind of curious, you talked about the need to be sustainably financially healthy internally, but also the need for transparency and talking to donors about all your results. Mm-hmm. If I'm starting an organization, what would you recommend to me to walk that fine line between being transparent and potentially not getting anyone to invest in me?
Well, the first thing I would say is I hope before you start anything, you look around at the more social business nonprofits per square inch than anywhere else in the world where you're standing right now, and make absolutely certain that there isn't somebody to partner with and that you have the humility to do that as step one. Once you've done that and you've become convinced that indeed I am going to go down this road, I have something new that I want to do, I think that there are some models out there that if you have measurement and management thinking from the beginning, and if you know that this is where you want to get to, I think that has to be sort of a guiding principle. One of the things where we stand right now, and from what I see, is that a lot of the thinking on this whole subject gets back to that 1% problem. That the models that are being suggested, randomized control trials and some of these other things, presume bigness and hugeness and a tremendous amount of resources. There has not been that much thinking and that much evolving about going to small scale and less expensive ways of going about doing this. I do think there's some very interesting work going on when it comes to getting information from the people being served on the ground that can be done cheaply and effectively. I'd be happy to, if you email me, send you out some more information on that. In terms of the balance between transparency and your internals, I think that your guiding principle should be to be as transparent as you possibly can while not divulging something that may be of critical confidentiality to the organization. That's the best I can do at the 50,000 foot level.
Great, thank you.
Sure.
Yeah, hi, my name is Wayne Clark from My Timing. How would you know if someone is looking at your non-for-profit when you register on Charity Navigator?
How would you know if somebody is looking at your nonprofit? Well, there is not necessarily any absolutely clear, positive way for you to know that. But one of the ways that we do know that people, one of the ways that people do find out about it is we're aware that there are organizations that have gotten millions of dollars and smaller amounts. And the person will say, I'm giving to you because of your rating on Charity Navigator. They never heard of these people before, never heard of them before. When it comes to organizations where their rating may have been less than stellar, they've also gotten calls from people saying, what happened here? And so typically, that is the way. It's not that there's a total flow of every single hit on that page that's given to you, but in terms of at least those kind of people that either are giving more or giving less, typically you would hear from them. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hi. Jessica Siegel. I'm on the journalism faculty, and I teach a lot of reporting skills and investigative work.
Hi.
And I've actually used Charity Navigator, in fact, for a recent story that I was looking into a foundation that seemed to collect a tremendous amount of money from corporations. It looked to me like a front for marketing interests. And when I pulled their 1099 and I looked at Charity Navigator, they had a decent rating. It was extremely difficult for me to even understand. They didn't report where the money was coming from. There was no specifics on how much each corporate interest was giving, though they hinted at it. They didn't say where it was going. And it also seemed like there was a little bit of apples and oranges within Charity Navigator in that an advocacy group couldn't be held up to the same standard as a program group where they actually had a program and then you could speak to beneficiaries. I mean, they were just promoting a point of view, which happened to be the same point of view of a major corporate interest.
Yes.
So I'm wondering if you could give some help to me and to everyone in the room on how to use Charity Navigator more effectively.
Okay.
And if in fact what you've been talking about this whole speech may be in fact what I ran into is that ultimately you couldn't evaluate.
One of the things that would be very helpful for me is if you would email me, or if you can come after.
Yeah, I'd be happy to.
I'd really like to talk to you about that specific situation. So, but talking more broadly and more generally, the thing that I struggle with every single day is to strike a balance between scale and depth. The challenge for all of us that are trying to do this work is, on the one hand, trying to cover enough organizations so that it reaches enough people, and to go into enough depth so that it's meaningful. Charity Navigator started out with 7 metrics. We're up to 39 metrics, and we're trying to go deeper and look at organizations from more angles than ever before. We are not perfect, but I can tell you this. We have a system called a donor advisory system that we created a couple of years ago. If we get wind of an organization that is fraudulent, that is being investigated, that there's some kind of lawsuit and embezzlement, we will stop rating that organization, and we will give it a donor advisory designation when we become aware of it. And I say when we become aware of it. And so we have about 150, 160 donor advisories at this point. It's continually, unfortunately, increasing. We also have another thing called a CN watch list. If we become aware of an investigation from a reporter, from a reputable reporter, and I know that you are, we would definitely want that information, and we would be watching that organization. We might not stop rating it, but we're saying there's some information here that is worrisome. We're watching this to see if it leads to an investigation, if it leads to some kind of additional action, because we're concerned. We also, ourselves, our staff, if we see anomalies in the 990s, if someone points out to us something strange that's going on within the data, we'll also give donor advisories in those cases. So that's why I really want to know about this particular situation, because we are very mindful of not wanting to give a high rating to an organization that is abusing their status for lining pockets.
I very much appreciate the invitation and will absolutely take you up on it.
Right.
And in fact, I'm also on the board of the Deadline Club Society of Professional Journalists, and I'll just make this invitation public. We'd love to have you come and actually give a seminar to journalists on how to use Charity Navigator, and then you can get all kinds of stories like this.
Wow. Okay, so you've made my day.
All right.
I'm glad we came. Done.
Okay, thank you.
Outcomes, results right there. Thank you. Yes.
Hi, I'm Rachel Bello.
Hi.
So I was struggling while I was listening to you, trying to differentiate between the kinds of data that you're talking about and information you're talking about, which is organizational information about organizations as the unit of measurement, as the unit of delivery of value, as the mm-hmm. as the unit of meaning,
mm-hmm.
because you're Charity Navigator and you're mm-hmm. inheriting that entire paradigm.
Mm-hmm.
There's another way of looking at this from the social challenges back to what is the most effective way of delivering resources to eradicate poverty, to clean water, to improve the public education system, et cetera. I don't know that the organizations, no matter how good they are, the nonprofit organizations, mm-hmm. is the most effective delivery of resources.
Mm-hmm.
But one thing that you haven't mentioned that seems inevitable and necessary is there is no way that the nonprofit sector, whether it's fundamentally reorganized or not, is mm-hmm. going to get to the point of understanding and measuring and understanding and then delivering data on its effectiveness in the absence of radically upgraded technology, which is expensive, and more important, the capacity to manage that technology. Because you wouldn't imagine that the corporate sector would be able to deliver to its shareholders anything meaningful without vast technology infrastructure and the capacity to manage it.
Okay.
So how do we deal with that?
Well, I think you're wrong, quite frankly. If that were the case, if it was that impossible, I wouldn't be standing here saying that we can get past this. I mean, I humbly submit this to you. I'm working with people, you know, because I'm out there, I'm aware of work that's going on from a number of innovative, creative people that are trying to find ways to have this technology at a simple level, at a scalable level, for small organizations to be able to do stuff in this area, and it's far less complicated than we necessarily believe it to be. Once you get past randomized control trials And you get down to trying to measure something to make change in people's lives and behavioral change and tracking that. It is not necessarily an insurmountable, highly technical, and highly complicated matter. I think that the biggest challenge is a mind shift for people to say, I've been doing this all this time, and I thought it was working well, and then I find out that it's really not, and I need to be open to having other data and looking at other ways of doing this. I have stories of people who started a program, and because they were, first, they wouldn't gather data, and as a result of that, they didn't know. And then they started to gather data, and their assumptions turned out to be wrong. And it was very simple data, very simple tracking that can get you on this road. It does not have to be that elaborate. Just basic asking people about what they received and is an example of something that is not necessarily that hard to do. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Vibor. I'm the director and United Nations representative of a nonprofit organization called Jaipur Foot. It's centered actually in headquartered in Jaipur, India, but we are serving the disabled people by providing artificial limbs. These are actually low-cost artificial limbs that we've developed with collaboration with Stanford and MIT. We developed a low-cost prosthetic comparable to a German artificial limb for about $70. And we work out of 27 countries, headquartered in India. And a common problem that we face, we formulated officially in the United States recently about a year and a half ago, but the organization's been around for about 39 years. Now, the main dilemma that we face is that we have an amazing, stunning project, even like an artificial limb that we've developed, but we face the problem of like how to exactly fund our organization. We have, arguably one of the best technologies available, and recently put into context, in 2009, Time magazine hailed the 50 best inventions of the year 2009. So we definitely have the product that, many NGOs are looking at worldwide about, but now the thing is, we're trying to attract U.S. investors to actually, solicit funds to the organization. Now, what are your thoughts on that?
You should do it.
But what is the strategy and the marketing strategy that we actually try to create videos and like testimonials and send it back to the people so it creates like a touching feeling or emotional connection? Mm-hmm. Because you did allude in your presentation that emotional connection is the greatest, I think, satisfaction.
I think when it really gets down to a specific organization and how to go about doing that, one of the things it actually gets back to the earlier question. And now I'm going to sort of contradict myself and sort of support you, okay? So now I'm going to argue your point. Up until a little while ago, when small organizations would say, how are we possibly going to do this? I would say to them, there's a place called the Center for What Works, and for $500, they can help you build a logic model. And then about 6 months back, the head of that organization said to me, don't you ever say that ever again. That is wrong. I was wrong. I don't say that anymore. It takes more than that. $10,000, I can get something going. So there's a place in the middle, you see, but it's not that simple. The point I'm trying to make there also segues to you, which is, I also think the point that she was making is, you need somebody to help you answer that question that's an expert that looks at your specific situation. I can't, from here, really give you guidance on how to go about doing that. You really should reach out to experts out there. You may have to find some resources to do it to help you figure out the best way for you to get that funding that you require and the best model to go about doing it, being a social business or a nonprofit or whatever might work best. But I don't think I could help you beyond that from here.
Thank you.
But do it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Ken, Tony Martinetti, how are
you? Hey, hi.
Good to see you. And
same.
I'd like to, the gentleman who was just speaking, can I make a recommendation to you? It is... It's an organization, it's a nonprofit itself that helps growing and not necessarily startup, but organizations get to a sustainable funding among individuals, and it's called causeeffective.org. Causeeffective.org.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yes,
you're welcome.
I couldn't do that. He could do that, but I can't do
thank
that.
You.
I'm interested in the thieves and the scoundrels because it sounds like it's a bigger...
Yeah.
Proportion of the sector than
you.
I realize.
Yeah.
So can you give me some of share some of the metrics around whether that give you such concern?
Well, actually, and it's very personal also, Tony. I spent 30 years in the nonprofit sector, and I actually got to a point where I had one thief that I worked for after another, and I actually had this sort of why me kind of an experience, because I was like, I can't believe it. I can't believe how many people there are out there that I've experienced. Maybe I've got, you know, bad something, but it's just, it's so unbelievable to me. And so it really struck me. And then at Charity Navigator, where we see organizations where people are lying, where people are just stealing from the nonprofit, where people are just fabricating all.
Well, like the veteran, yeah, I'm thinking like the Navy veterans.
Well, yeah, so here's an example of
but,
that.
But it's, to me, it's a small proportion that gets a lot of headlines.
Well, that's.
But it makes it sound, but you make it sound like it's a larger proportion.
I think that you're right, but there's a place in the middle. It's another one of these kind of situations where, on the one hand, there's no question that when it comes to the media and public consciousness, the bad apples are often the stories that we hear about. And the danger is that that can give people the impression that you know, how can I give to any organization? And I always try to say to the reporters, please let people know the good news, the hope, the positive is the majority are good or are trying to be good, and that for all those scoundrels, even though I think it's bigger than we admit, it's not the majority, and it's not what the story should be in the public's consciousness. But it is big, and it happens, you mentioned veterans, it happens to be that the people who sacrifice or put their lives on the line for this country, veterans, firefighters, police,
yeah, the first
they're
responder.
The organizations where we see the most scandals, the people that are ripping off the public the most tend to be, and also cancer, kids with cancer, it's pathetic, it's disgusting. It makes me really angry. And I have seen it myself personally, so I know the reality of it. I'm not saying that it's that it's the majority, but when I hear people say it's a trivial thing, it's not a big deal, it's rare, I know they're wrong.
So you're evaluating 7,000 charities. Yeah. What proportion are you finding thieves and scoundrels?
Well, we're up to 160, okay? But you have to understand that there are 1 million 501c3s. And so the good news is that we're covering where 55% of the money goes with those because of the concentration. Those 8,000 charities that we're at, roughly 8,000 at this point, get 55%. They get $110 billion out of the $200 billion. They get a lion's share of that $2 trillion. But we have a sense that this is the tip of the iceberg, and the rest of the iceberg is underneath, but we're getting the anecdotal information, is what I'm trying to say to you, from these kind of stories and from our own experience and from colleagues, that the amount of these stories that you hear about, that people investigate, that we know about, because the people that are monitoring, there's less and less of them to oversee this, it's an intuitive thing.
Yeah, and also you're evaluating the larger ones. I think a lot of the trouble is that at grassroots, very small levels, where it's like the policeman's fund.
Very well, yes, yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thanks.
Yes, sure.
Hello.
Yes. Hi.
Hi, my name is Nadir, and I'm an emotional donor. My question is
about... a good start, very good start.
Yeah, I can say why I said that, but my question is about social businesses, and you mentioned that Charity Navigators, you know, in 5.0 is going to go towards rating it, so pardon me if it's not in the fray. But my question is about, I have two questions for you, actually. So one is about, I don't know if you heard
Guess
about...
Ask them one at a time, because I'm getting old. And I'll answer it, and then we'll go to the second one.
So I don't know if you heard about WATSI, W-A-T-S-I, WATSI.org, which is, I don't work for them, which is the first sort of social business, sponsored or that got into the Y Combinator. Y Combinator sort of funded that social business. And they have an interesting model to talk about their financials. What they've done is they've put all their financials online.
Yes.
So they have this Google Doc, which I thought I was Googling about them. I thought I found an accidental document, which is not supposed to be public.
Right.
I thought, yeah, I can actually see all their stuff. But I figured out later on looking through their website, they actually, that's their model.
Right.
They're putting everything online. So one is, what is your view about this kind of thing where you know you show all the money on the site, you know?
Yeah.
And they also list the name of their patients, where they are in the...
They list the name of who?
They list the name of their beneficiaries and, you know, how far
they've
reached.
Well, I don't know. Well, okay. Now you sort of went... I think I said earlier, when it comes to the organization, I think the guiding star of being as transparent as you can should be the model. There is a place for certain information you may need to have confidential, but I think you should be very careful to keep it to the bare minimum and really be sure that you actually have to, rather than groupthink that convinces you that this is something that you shouldn't share. So as a general principle, the sharing of the financial information we think is very good. We want to see not just the IRS forms, for example, for the nonprofits, but we also want to see their audited financial statements online, as an example, more and more of that. We at Charity Navigator have a report we submit to the board at each board meeting, and then we put it up for the public to see in terms of our results. So the model of more sharing of this information, we applaud. But the thing where you sort of went into the caution, though, of course, is it's self-report, number one. So it may appear that it is accurate, but if we run into an occasional scoundrel and thief, it could be a vast fiction. So just because it looks cool, this is the danger that we, you know, the appearance can be one thing, the reality could be another. I'm not saying that's the case here by any means. Please be clear, lawyers, I didn't mean that. But the other part of this that you said that sort of went off a tripwire a little bit is, if an organization is sharing the specifics about a person that's being served, there are some real very powerful rules about privacy and privacy of information. So I hope that if they are sharing that, they are very mindful and they have the willing and active participation of the person being served in that process, and they don't just do it without that. That's the only thing I would say there.
All right, makes sense. And my second and final question is, so say if I have $500 to donate in a year, and I have to compare, say, something WOTC that's new versus, like, say, Kiva, which is another microfinance, microloan, social impact organization.
Yes.
And say I want to use your tool, Charity Navigator. So apart from the ratings, how can I actually compare these two organizations?
Yeah, I think somebody actually had mentioned, I think the person from the journalism school had mentioned, you had mentioned about the app, not necessarily comparing apples and oranges. And there is a challenge there. And there is work being done to try to get better at the comparisons. But so when you're looking at Charity Navigator and you're wanting to compare two different organizations, and are they both on Charity Navigator, or you say one is and one is not? I'm not sure.
I'm saying if I have money to donate and I want to see which organization is creating more impact, and say beyond the rating, how can I compare impact?
Oh, well, welcome to the battle for the soul of the social sector. An outstanding question. I'm with you, indeed. And we will leave it as that question. And I hope that you see why we are doing everything we can at Charity Navigator to try to drive more of that information out there. That is the best I can do to answer your question. Good question. No answer.
Thank you.
This will be our last question.
Okay. Hi. My name's Rayanne Hanchy, and I'm a fellow social entrepreneur. I appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
I heard you say, and I think we can all agree, that we need to funnel resources to the most highly effective organizations, and also that we need to give resources to those innovators. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes, those are at odds given typical funding timelines. Yeah. So I'm wondering, do you have any examples of any organizations that are doing that well, or any suggestions for how organizations can balance those two often conflicting objectives?
I have personal favorites. They're just mine. This is not so I'm now going to step outside of Charity Navigator. Groups that I like, there's a group in Boston that's called ROCA, R-O-C-A. It is a relatively small nonprofit. It is very results-driven, and built it with blood, sweat, and tears because the leadership had the humility to say, we need to try to fix this and do it better. There's a bigger group that is sort of considered the gold standard, and I'm not suggesting this is, they actually do randomized control trials, which is called the Nurse Family Partnership, which you may have heard of, which is based in Colorado. There are a number of these kind of organizations. But I do think, as I said earlier, there is a problem of scale that smaller organizations and models for smaller organizations are hard to find. If you email me, I can give you some suggestions for some groups that focus on trying to help the innovators at small scale get the resources and to measure and manage.
Thank you.
Sure.
But you want to take one more?
One more time. Social Impact Exchange, Ann Sherman.
Yeah,
I know you.
Nice to see you.
I mean, hi.
Would it be inappropriate to mention the S&I 100? Just
is part of the Social Impact Exchange, and it's a platform that features about 113 organizations working in health, education, youth development, and poverty alleviation, all of which have outcomes evaluations that have been vetted by an independent evaluator, and they're all going to scale. And their Nurse Family Partnership is there, ROCA is there, and about 111 others of different sizes around the country.
Thank you.
SNI 100, you can go to si100.org.
Thank you.
Sure.
That was a good question.
So thanks so much, everybody, for coming. A huge thank you to you.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Gabriel, really. Thank you.